can never pass thoughtless and cruel judgments upon his fellows, because in his tenderness of heart he is ever with them in their pain. But to have reached this ripened sympathy, it must be that one has loved much, suffered much, and sounded the dark depths of sorrow. It springs from acquaintance with the profoundest experiences, so that a man has had conceit, thoughtlessness, and selfishness burnt out of his heart. No man can have true sympathy who has not been, in some measure at least, a man of sorrows and acquainted with grief. But the sorrow and grief must have passed, must have ripened into a fixed kindness and habitual calm. To have suffered so much in a certain direction that suffering is finished, and only its particular wisdom remains, enables one, wherever that suffering presents itself, to understand and deal with it by pure sympathy. And when one has been perfected by suffering in many directions, he becomes a center of rest and healing for the sorrowing and broken-hearted who are afflicted with the afflictions which he has experienced and conquered. As a mother feels the anguish of her suffering child, so the man of sympathy feels the anguish of suffering men. Such is the highest and holiest sympathy, but a sympathy much less perfect is a great power for good in human life, and a measure of it everywhere and every day is needed. While rejoicing in the fact that in every walk of life there are truly sympathetic people, one also perceives that harshness, resentment, and cruelty that are all too common. These hard qualities bring their own sufferings, and there are those who fail in their business or particular work entirely because of the harshness of their disposition